Hi, today is Friday, May 20th. I'm Mike Malcolm, and here's what's coming up at the Church of St. Mary. This week, we celebrate all things related to the Guardians, the School of St. Mary. Yesterday, they did their awards assembly, their famous drive around where 8th graders throw candy to younger kids as they ride around on crazily decorated cars. Then they did graduation mass last night. So congratulations to those kids. There's a lot of parish kids who are doing great things. For example, Carson Rury and his family go to mass here. Carson was honored by Bishop Kelly High School with their prestigious Brother Norman McCarthy Award. Goes to show you that this is just a fantastic community that takes education really seriously. We also want to thank all the people in the parish who are teachers or support staff or principals or secretaries or doing anything with schools, whether it's public school, other private schools, or the School of St. Mary. Specifically, I want to clap for Susan Lang and Venus Trantham. They are retiring from the School of St. Mary this summer, and we want to thank them for all their years and years of service and wish them the very best and a happy retirement. Also, a beloved part of our parish is Father Jack, who is being transferred from the Church of St. Mary to St. Bernard here in Tulsa. I am looking for photos of Father Jack, so if you have photos of him at social gatherings, saying mass, doing a sacrament, weddings, baptisms, anything that you think the general parish would enjoy seeing, I have a use for those photos. Now, I'm not going to go into detail because Father Jack watches these videos. Hi, Father Jack. But if you have pictures, email me a copy and I'd love to get those. Looking ahead at Mass this weekend in the vestibule, Christine Hassink will be there to answer questions and help register people for Vacation Bible School and Middle School Service Week. Then also the Knights of Columbus are doing a raffle. They'll be selling tickets where you might win $10,000. All the proceeds go to support the Oklahoma Center of Family Love, which is a Oklahoma facility that supports Oklahomans, adults with developmental disabilities, living in this place, the Center of Family Love. Your support would be greatly appreciated. Speaking of Mass, two big things to talk about, the loop and communion. So the loop, last week I told you, oh, we got it fixed, everything's fine. Didn't work out that way, unfortunately. So the loop is still damaged. Assist to Hear, our installer, is awesome. They're coming out next week to find a permanent solution for this. We'll get it fixed. And so this week, no loop, but hopefully the next weekend we'll have something in place. Masks. So, you know that one section on the left that is designated as masks only? So we're going to have a small change to the rest of the church. It's been the custom here since the pandemic began for anyone, priest, deacon, layperson, who is distributing communion to wear a mask. So from now on, the Eucharistic minister who distributes communion to people in the mask section, he or she will be wearing a mask. That only makes sense. But for the rest of the church, if someone is distributing communion to the unmasked section, the minister of communion may himself or herself be unmasked. So if that makes sense, that's what we're doing. And just a favor that I have to ask, if you wish to wear a mask, that's great. You can wear it anywhere in the church. But if you wish to not wear a mask, please make sure that you're seated only in the unmasked section of the church. Let's keep that masked section masked. And then that makes the people who sit there and who may need to sit there because of an immune system issue or something, or just their comfort, we want to make them feel safe and comfortable when they come to Mass. So I appreciate your help in that. You have a great weekend. I will see you sometime soon.
My name is Jack Cruz.
My name's Pat Simons.
I'm Betty Goldwaz.
I'm in charge of the Home Improvement Ministry.
The Home Improvement Ministry guys have been such a godsend for me.
I've had my kitchen sink faucet replaced. The hose on it broke and it had to be replaced. And my shower, it was spewing water everywhere.
They have done a lot of yard work for me. They've repaired a gate, a wooden gate, installed a doorbell, fixed some outdoor lights.
We do work days approximately twice a year where we have many projects for the parishioners in need. However, we do have an emergency group.
And each time they were out there within that day.
They were great and got the job done on a Saturday morning.
So if you have an emergency arise, a small project, not large projects, but small projects, please call the parish office, ask for Sharon Hannish, and we'll try to help you out.
It's good to know that you can call Sharon. They'll get some help.
Wow, this home improvement emergency team is absolutely awesome. And these gentlemen, they have anywhere from 10, 15, 20 years of experience in their lives that they know how to do the job, and they do an excellent job.
Good morning and welcome to the Church of St. Mary. Today is the sixth Sunday of Easter. The opening hymn can be found in your blue gather hymnal, number 352. I want to walk as a child of the light, number 352. Please stand.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us call to mind our sins and to prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that we may celebrate with heartfelt devotion in these days of joy, which we keep in honor of the risen Lord, that we live in remembrance we may always hold on to in what we do. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Some who had come down from Judea were instructing the brothers, "Unless you are circumcised according to the Mosaic practice, you cannot be saved." Because there arose no little dissension and debate by Paul and Barnabas with them, it was decided that Paul and Barnabas and some of the others should go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders about this question. The apostles and elders, in agreement with the whole church, decided to choose representatives and to send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. The ones chosen were Judas, who was called Barsabbas, and Silas, leaders among the brothers. This is the letter delivered by them. "The apostles and the elders, your brothers, to the brothers in Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia of Gentile origin, greetings. Since we have heard that some of our number who went out without any mandate from us have upset you with their teachings and disturbed your peace of mind, we have with one accord decided to choose representatives and to send them to you along with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, who have dedicated their lives to the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we are sending Judas and Silas, who will also convey the same message by word of mouth. It is the decision of the Holy Spirit and of us not to place on you any burden beyond these necessities, namely to abstain from meat sacrificed to idols, from blood, from meats of strangled animals, and from unlawful marriage. If you keep free of these, you will be doing what is right. Farewell." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. A reading from the book of Revelation. The angel took me in spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God. It gleamed with the splendor of God. Its radiance was like that of a precious stone, like jasper, clear as crystal. It had a massive high wall with 12 gates where 12 angels were stationed, and on which names were inscribed the names of the 12 tribes of the Israelites. There were 3 gates facing east, 3 north, 3 south, and 3 west. The wall of the city had 12 courses of stone as its foundation, on which were inscribed the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb. The city had no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gave it light, and its lamp was the Lamb. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever loves me will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our dwelling with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. Yet the word you hear is not mine, but that of the Father who sent me. I have told you this while I am with you. The Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I told you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give it to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled or afraid. You heard me tell you, I am going away, and I will come back to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it happens, so that when it happens, you may believe." The Gospel of the Lord. There was a story that appeared in the Rocky Mountain newspaper back in 1909, and it went like this. You have heard from that fretted Colorado clergyman who, with a small salary, a large family, and a grouchy congregation, is trying hard to serve God, to obey the law, and make both ends meet. His task was that of the Hercules for many things: sickness, visitors, heterodoxy, and church quarrels came rapidly up to trouble him. So when a solemn-visaged parishioner blandly asked the parson, "What is life?" he replied wearily, "Life? Well, it's just one dang thing after another." And so it seems. Every day, there is at least one more thing that crops up in the news at the local, national, or international level. Neither can we forget about the personal crises that seem to pop up time and time again. And sometimes the stress of it all can be overwhelming. Most definitely, the reality of life's recurring challenges is nothing new. We are reminded of this in today's scriptures, particularly in the gospel reading from the Last Supper. I came upon a commentary written by Father Joseph Krempa, who recounted how Jesus is really preparing his disciples for the crises of his passion and then his ultimate departure, where he will return to the Father. It is called the Farewell Address, the gospel that we just heard. Aside from this immediate situation, Jesus also knew that his church would be facing crises in every generation to come. We heard about one of these in our first reading from the Acts of the Apostles, as the church confronts a decision on how to integrate the Gentile converts into the church and what was going to be required to keep the peace and unity among the Jewish Christians and the Gentile Christians. Rooted in that solution are three pieces of equipment that Jesus imparts on his church to handle this and future crises: his word, his spirit, and his peace. In contemporary business acumen, there are four widely accepted elements of essential success for crisis management: prevent, plan, practice, and perform. These terms remind companies to minimize threats, develop crisis plans, rehearse those plans, and execute them effectively when needed. It's kind of a self-reliant approach, and it's extended by many self-help authors and books to the personal level. A summary of principles to remind when dealing with personal crisis, especially if we want to maintain the norm and keep work focus sharp and moving ahead no matter what: they can be grouped into two big categories: things to do and things not to do. The things to do, well, determine what type of support you need, whether it's at home or at work. Tell your colleagues what's happening so they feel compassion about your situation. Make clear, specific requests for your coworkers and boss so that they know how they can help you. And don't forget about the don'ts. Don't feel like you have to tell everyone directly. It's okay to ask close colleagues to explain to others what's going on. Share every detail. Don't do that of your situation. And don't assume it will be painful to continue working during this time. You know, sometimes if you go to work and go to the office, it can be a comfort to you. A result-driven approach, managed internally when involving personal crisis, is the prevailing advice of the secular world. It is the proverbial "I got this" mentality, acting out the idea that when the going gets tough, well, the tough just get going. While active participation and effort are most definitely a part of managing any crisis, There is a surefire method ready to lead the way, an approach that relies heavily on the Lord, on His Word, on His Spirit, and on His peace. In an era of spin, when crises sometimes get manufactured or skewed in a way that distorts the magnitude, cause, or resolution, many trust in an unchanging rock, a rock of God's truth recorded in Scripture. When we permit the Word of Christ to provide us with God's perspective, His Word lifts our vision beyond the immediate presence to the larger drama that's confronting our life. You can kind of think of it like pixels on a computer screen. If you zoom in and focus too much on each little piece, it gets distorted. But if you step back, you start to see that those dots become a picture of peace. God's Word is there for every one of us in every circumstance. If we let Him handle the detail, if we trust Him and follow His Word, then all we have to do is allow that to happen, and God will manage whatever situation we are dealing with. The second piece of God's crisis management plan is the gift of the Holy Spirit. God promises the Holy Spirit that He will dwell within us, drawing us to Himself. And we don't have to wonder where God is, even in the darkness of personal tragedy or darkness. We don't have to hunt for God. No, God dwells inside us through the power and promise of our baptisms and confirmation. In any crisis, we can know that the Holy Spirit is right there with us, working constantly in our life. The third part of God's crisis management plan, His peace. My peace is my gift to you, not as the world gives peace. Again, relying on Father Krempa again, he points out that the world defines peace as an absence of conflict. But you know that kind of peace can be destroyed in a moment's notice. A single act of terrorism, a single bullet, a random act of violence. That kind of peace does not last. The peace that Christ gives is the tranquility of order within, no matter what is happening outside. That is the peace the world cannot give us. The peace of Christ lies inside each one of you, ready to consume you in a never-ending flood of God's love. This past Wednesday, May 18th, the Church honored the first Pope John in its history. During the 6th century, the Church found itself in the midst of yet another crisis, the Arian heresy. Pope John was sent by a Western Arian king to present arguments about the position that denied the divinity of Christ to the great Emperor Constantine. Upon his return to Rome, Pope John declared something that this king that sent him wasn't expecting, and that was the unwavering truth that Jesus was indeed true God and true man. And for his efforts, the Arian king cast Pope John into prison, where he was left to starve to death. Shortly before his death, writing in prison, Pope John I reminded the faithful of a key element of the way to becoming a disciple of Jesus. And he wrote, "Dear brothers and sisters, I pray God may open your eyes and let you see what hidden treasure He bestows on us in the trials from which the world thinks only to flee. Shame, turns into honor when we seek God's glory. Present affliction becomes the source of heavenly glory. To those who suffer wounds in fighting his battles, God opens his arms in loving, tender friendship, which is more delightful by far than anything our earthly efforts might produce. If we have any sense, we shall yearn for those open arms of God. This is the way Christ and his disciples have always traveled. Jesus called it the narrow way, but it leads straight to life. That is why he tells us if we want to join him, we shall travel the way he took. And so we pray, O God, grant that our hearts may find no rest and seek no other food in this world, save in hardship and suffering beside the Lord's cross.
Let us stand and profess our faith. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible.
I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made. For our sin, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead
and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Trusting in our Father in heaven, we now ask him these, our prayers.
You promised to be with your disciples to the end of the world. Stay with us today. Remain with us always, leading the way for Pope Francis and all bishops. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That elected, appointed government officials work in cooperation with one another for the common good of those they have sworn to serve. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That grace floods the hearts of our parishioners, especially the parents of young children, to fuel a desire to grow ever closer to Jesus as his faithful disciples. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In thanksgiving for the gift of education, as many graduate from various levels of learning, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the dignity of the human person is always upheld, and that we take an active role in local issues, working together to address our neighbors in need. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an unwavering defense of every human person from the moment of conception through natural death, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We ask the Lord to send down his Holy Spirit and provide physical, emotional, and spiritual healing to the chronically ill. We pray in a special way for those being treated actively this week: Gary Nussel, Meg Sullivan, Father Paul Eishoff, and all the names recorded in the Book of Intentions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We also ask the Lord in his mercy to welcome the recently deceased to the place that he has prepared for them. We pray especially for members of our own families who have gone before us in faith. Together we pray. Eternal rest grant to them, O Lord.
And let perpetual life shine upon them. May their souls and the souls of all the faithful depart through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Good and gracious God, hear our prayers and grant them according to your will. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God and the Almighty Father. May our prayers rise up to you, O Lord, together with the sacrificial offerings, so that purified by your graciousness, we may be conformed to the mysteries of your love. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, a universe cast down is renewed, and integrity of life is restored to us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy, unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and David, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you the sacrifice of praise that they offered for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glories of our Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter, Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers and all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and count among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritually acceptable so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Lord, and hope that so rests on
Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension to heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and always sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Anna, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen. At the Savior's command and form of divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father,
Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we have the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Turn to one another and offer a sign of Christ's peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who restore us to eternal life in the resurrection of Christ, increase in us, we pray, the fruits of this Paschal sacrament, and pour into our hearts the strength of this saving food. Through Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Some quick announcements. So in the vestibule, the Knights of Columbus are selling raffle tickets after Mass. You might win $10,000. You'll be supporting the Center of Family Love in Oklahoma Residence for Adults with Disabilities. Vacation Bible School is next month. Middle school is already all sold out. You can get a waiting list for that and also the other grades. There's openings in third, fourth, and fifth grade. So sounds like it's going to be really good this year because it's really popular. So I encourage you to go to Vacation Bible School. Our ministers of communion will no longer be wearing masks after Memorial Day, except for those ministers on the west side of the church over there where our kind of our mass section is. Those who feel more comfortable receiving communion from someone with a mask may go to that line over there for communion. And your safety and and comfort is a priority here. Everyone who sits in the west section, once again, that section over there, must wear a mask. We appreciate your consideration for our parishioners who are immunocompromised. And thank you to our family handbell choir, which you heard play at communion. There's room for new members. The family or beginners in the handbell choir, as well as the advanced handbell choir, you can contact Lyndon or Karen if you're interested in joining in the fall. And just a shout out to the choir again. You sounded very, very good. I thought, yeah. Yeah, whatever you guys played at offertory, that was a bomb. That was awesome. I love that. And then lastly, Bruce Sanders, our seminarian, with us this past year. His last weekend is next month. He goes back to seminary next week. It's been a long Sunday. Next week is his last weekend here, so be sure to say bye to Bruce, and thanks for all the work he's done for us here. The Lord be with you.
With
my mighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Mass is ended. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.